So there's also a rumor that it's a fabricated beef to bring back some hype and some spark to hip hop or rap music, because rap music sales have been down, or, you know what I'm saying? So I don't know how true that is. If it is true, then both of them being extorted. Both of them are dropping and giving 50. You know what I'm saying? But I don't know how true that is. But how soon are you one that believe in, like, the clock? How soon someone's supposed to respond? Do you think there's a time limit on the response?
So Kendrick took a little long. He did. Took a little while. I think Euphoria would have been a lot more impactful if it released right after Push-Ups. But because the Taylor Swift shit that Drake kind of predicted kind of played in favor for Drake. But, you know, not for nothing. Again, back to the Jay and Nas conversation. Takeover came out in September. Motherfucker, Ether didn't come out till December. So,
exactly.
But then again, different generations, so we don't really know. You know, music is a lot faster.
Yeah, but like I said, if they really had something to say, the radio and mixtapes was also waiting for the drops as well, too. Because I think Takeover did, I mean, I think Ether did release like a week or so before the album came out. You know what I'm saying? But still, yeah, it was still 2 months later.
Three months later.
But if you want to be technical, Drake took longer to respond to Like That than Kendrick did to respond to Push-Ups.
It was
like 2 weeks later, whereas, you know, this would have been the second week or whatever. Somebody did the math on it or whatever. I don't care. Like you said, okay. You know, there was months between diss tracks or whatever. And to be honest, Kendrick been waiting 10 years. So
now let me ask you this. We're going to do the hypothetical, okay? We're going to do a little quick hypothetical. Drake response, right? And it's good. It's like, it's really good. Kendrick either does not respond or is not as impactful as either Euphoria or what Drake puts out on his second track. Let's say Drake is one for one.
Okay.
Does Drake get into the category of the top five artists?
I mean, he's already there. On most people's, he's already top five, some top three, or, you know, some. Now, me personally, are you asking, or?
Well, I'm gonna be complete. You know, like, you know, we've had this debate with Drake. Like, you don't really rock with his music; you prefer his rapping over singing, which is cool. I will tell you this, right? I think Drake in a hip hop top five, I wouldn't be able to put him on there.
Mm-hmm.
But I think Drake is a top five artist of all time.
Sure. And so I agree with that. I mean, at that point, when you talk about the artistry, that's when you go into the numbers and his comparison to Michael Jackson and the Beatles and hit records and features and all that stuff. Absolutely. Now, I feel that's part of the reason why he's in this position that he's in now, where a lot of people don't rock with him or don't like him, because he gets credit for a lot of the hits and stuff that whatever. Like, he just jumped on that singing dude, Four Bats.
Yeah.
He just made that remix, and that people are going to act like he broke dude's career. That song was buzzing way before Drake got on the remix. And I had this argument recently with my boy Charles, shout out to Charles, about the Migos. People give Drake the credit of breaking the Migos, where Versace and a lot of other songs were still kind of buzzing before he jumped on the remix. He's not on the original versions of these songs. He comes in after a lot of times and jumps on. Now, granted, he does do features, you know, with people, you know, on new songs, but a lot of times he jumps on something that's already moving. You know what I'm saying? And gets on it like that.
So this is the thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
Kendrick Lamar is on his first album, Poetic Justice, and
Drake is on it. Mm-hmm.
So it was a charting record, right? Ross, we don't even got it. There's too many to count.
But let's not forget Drake's second album, which the one I said is arguably the best. Kendrick has a whole song on there. Drake's not even on it.
Buried Alive.
Yes, Drake's not even on it. He has all Kendrick, so he gave him some love too. Ironically, the album that most people say is the best one, maybe because Kendrick was. No, I'm not playing.
Nah.
But he's there. He hasn't had that type of success. Not success, but he hasn't had an album heralded that high since they've been beefing. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Coincidence? Right. I don't know.
Future.
But yeah, so as I'm saying, he gives and gets. So even on push-ups, he said, "I'm the hit maker that you all depend on." And it's like, are you saying the record labels depend on you? Or are you really saying all these artists owe you? You know what I'm saying? And that's why a lot of people don't, because like, man, you go, our LeBron conversation.
I don't want to go to that, but I'm just saying,
it's like you getting all the credit for you telling me the Migos wouldn't have been the Migos without Drake. 21 Savage wouldn't have been 21 Savage without Drake. Like, Future wouldn't have been Future without Drake. Rick Ross wouldn't have been Rick Ross without Drake. I don't know.
Because we just got to keep facts, right? Mm-hmm. The records that Drake are featured on, whether it be a record label decision, whatever it is, we can't deny that they popped off.
But Every Day I'm Hustling was Rick Ross's first single. Jay-Z was on the remix. That song popped. Before different. Drake was popping.
Def Jam. Def Jam. So, that's Def Jam. That's Def Jam. Different. A little different.
But his quote is, every number one single Rick Ross had that was because of me. That's not true. That's not true.
All right. Hold on.
Every Day I'm Hustling is his very first single. And that popped on its own. And then even Jay. So again, back to my point of Drake being this generation's Jay-Z. Jay-Z used to do that too. He used to jump on remixes. He just straight stole people's songs. Even his own label people. He stole the Pharrell joint from Emilio Sparks. I'm a hustler, babe. Like, he stole that from his own artists. So Jay used to do this type of thing too. You know what I'm saying? But again, Rick Ross was Rick Ross. His voice, his oh snap, we gotta, this is different. He had that persona. Again, we all know he's really a CEO, but he gave off the image of a drug kingpin from Miami. Boom, he was popping off his first single. But then we gonna say every hit you had was because of me?
Most hits, most.
Okay, but again, fine. All right. So, like you said, to your point, the label might have made those decisions. Hey, we need to get this guy to make a hit. Okay, fine. He got the hits. But Ross is still Ross without those hits. Not everybody gets a hit, but people are still respected artists, rappers in the game. So, but I give you that. He makes hits. I don't think he makes career. He takes it as, I'm making your career. You should thank me. Like, I don't know about that.
I agree with that statement. But once you get the Drake cosign, your stock increases tremendously.
Yeah, I don't know. I think that's where we're at today, where we talk about, again, that's why Kanye brought up Lucian and a lot of the business deals, and allegedly Drake is getting percentages of artists, you know, sales or streams on these songs. And a lot of people are like, yo, hold on. I didn't want him to get money from that. But it's like, again, you signed this deal. You have no control over your career. We do as we say. That's every artist. So again, the drop and give me 50 joint, every artist get caught up in them bad deals off the rip. You know what I'm saying? That's the industry. Until, again, 10 years, 12 years, 11 years later, you get to make your own imprint like both Kendrick and Drake have done.
So, all right. So I will put it to you this way, right?
Mm-hmm.
I don't think Rick Ross will be the same. I don't think Rick Ross has been the same since even before the album with Meek, right? I don't think French will be the same if he don't got that Drake Colson. I don't think ASAP Rocky.
So what song do you attribute to Drake making them bigger? Which song are you going off of?
For Ross?
Yeah.
I got Aston Martin Music.
Now, you don't think Rick Ross was already big before that? So again, let's go to his discography. His first album came out in 2006. That's years before Drake is even known. And he had Push It to the Limit. He had I'm a Boss. He had where is it? Every Day I'm Hustling is on there. Like, he's already Rick Ross, the boss. 2 years later, he drops his second album, Triller.
So
a year after that, Deeper Than Rap. Then he gets the Teflon Don. His fourth album is where he finally
gets... I gotta correct you. I'm a Boss came out in 2011.
Okay. So, this song called Boss something. I thought that was that. Okay. So, but he's so he telling me you telling me Rick Ross wasn't Rick Ross until four or five albums later.
So Ross's first album, not to knock it, but like it was all right.
So
it was all right.
When did he make what was it? Aston Martin Music or what was the one Drake was on?
Hold on, so. The second album was called Triller from Ross, right? And I'm looking at this, and I only see... This is when T-Pain is popping. So, and R. Kelly was doing these features, bro.
But my point is, one, two, three, Drake doesn't appear until Ross's fourth album. He's already four albums deep. You telling me Rick Ross is not Rick Ross by then? He's not the guy that he is already. I'm not even talking numbers and sales.
You know
we can say,
I'm
okay, fine.
No.
But
you know
his fourth album, people finally said, you know what? I like this guy thanks to this Drake feature. I want to listen to this Rick Ross guy now. Now. I'm going to listen to him now.
That's why I disagree, because then we got to look at the Khaled records.
But again, that's stuff that predates Drake.
The Khaled
records
predates,
My point is, Rick Ross is already four albums deep before we even get a Drake feature.
Hold on.
It's his fourth album.
Wait a minute, hold on. Because I want to make sure I got this down pat. Hold on. So Khaled, right? Hold on. Give me 1 second. Khaled's first album, nothing.
And not to cut you off, but Rick Ross's first album peaked at number one.
Okay.
It's platinum.
Okay.
What are we giving Drake credit for? Just because he made a couple hits four albums later? Ross had a platinum album already.
I agree. Okay.
We can say like it might be his biggest record or something like that, but Rick Ross was already again, nobody's putting Rick Ross in their top 5, 10, you know what I'm saying, list. Nobody's putting him up there. So I'm not even, you know what I'm saying, but to say, oh, your biggest hits was thanks to me, cool, but he is who he is already. Okay. Ross is Ross off the rip. He didn't break Ross. You know what I'm saying? So you.
No, that's not that. That's, I don't want to make it misconstrued. I'm not saying he broke Ross. I'm saying some of his biggest hits are with Drake.
So Aston Martin music peaked at 66. Like, it wasn't even a number one single. It wasn't even a number one single.
I'm talking more like Aston Martin music. I was gonna say Dice Pineapple, and I was gonna say Stay Scheming.
So Wale, so you saying, huh? Like Ross makes these songs without Drake. I think Ross is still Ross without Drake. Again, it's a whole nother conversation when we get into the numbers. That's a label thing. The money that's made on it, or the numbers and the streams, that's something that us as fans, you could care about that. Like, that's like the argument 50 Cent always had with number one. Everybody started worrying about number one records, whatever, because of 50 Cent. Cool. Yeah. Drake is playing that game. Cool. But that doesn't mean anything to a fan. Ross is Ross. Ross's fan base, some people, again, to take back what I said before, some people might have Ross in their top 3, 4, 5. But that those people were saying Ross is Ross without Drake, Khaled. So, you know what I'm saying? They got him up there. And I would say Ross is who he is without Drake. You know what I'm saying? Okay. I don't. Four albums later, he is who he is. He's already the biggest boss. He's already got that persona. He had beefs with 50 Cent, he had beefs with Cameron, like, he had beefs, like, he's done things by the time we get to Drake. You know what I'm saying? By the time we get to Drake starting his career, Ross is in his career.
Right. I'm not saying he started, though. I'm just saying, yeah, I got you. I got what you're
saying. But like I said, I don't feel, okay, I gave you your biggest hits or whatever. Even that, I had to look into the numbers, but the numbers game is always something that fans, I don't care. That's the money. That's the business. Because even the numbers game, both of them was getting jerked in their label at that point. Both of them was getting extorted, you know, to quote Drake. Neither one of y'all really saw nothing off of that song. To be honest. And again, that might have been bigger for Drake. He ended up taking that song, flipping it for his own album. Remember, it turned into... What was it? It was on Take Care, wasn't it? Which one came out first? Let me not say he took it, because if the Ross album came out first and then Drake flipped it for Paris Morton music.
For care package, I think they like re-released it as a care package, right?
So and this is early Drake, because when did his first album come out?
Drake's first album came out in 2010.
Right. So Drake's fourth album, I mean, Rick Ross's fourth album, Drake's first. Who helped who? So going back to Ross's point and Kendrick's point, you stood next to some black people to get your black card. You know what I'm saying? He helped you. And I'm not saying how true, but this is an opinion-based argument. And it's like, yo, I helped you, to be honest. I gave you some swag. I gave you some credibility standing next to me. You want to get into the numbers argument, but even bigger, the culture said, oh, you rolling with him? Okay, cool. You hang with the boss. I'm four albums in. Again, as a fan of Rick Frost fan is saying this, yo, his fourth album, oh, who does Lightskin do with him? Oh, I rock with him too. Cool. I'm going to listen to his song.
Okay. All right. I guess. I mean, sure. But I guess what I'm saying is, and this is something where, like, you can't really deny, whether it be, again, an executive decision, record label decision, publishing, whatever the case may be. Statistics show that when Drake was featured on some of these artists that he's currently beefing with now, whether it be Future, whether it be with even Metro Boomin and him did a record together, Migos that you mentioned, Ross, Kendrick, ASAP Rocky.
We don't know why.
We don't know why, but at the end of the day, statistics show record gets not only radio spins, but it gets some streaming spins on it because he's featured on it.
And the record label thanks him.
And
the record label thanks him. The artist is still who the artist was going to be. I'm sorry. I don't think he changed careers. He helped the label make some more money. I'll give you that. Kendrick is going to be Kendrick without Drake.
But then you also have to keep into consideration. Yeah, I'm not saying he created these artists and put them in this platform. He just gave them that boost from whatever record executive decision they made.
Did you listen to Kendrick because of Buried Alive?
No, I loved Kendrick since Section 80, bro.
Thank you. Thank you. That's my point. He didn't give you the look. Because again, they all came out around the same time. So he takes credit for putting them on his tour. I didn't go to that concert. I was a Kendrick fan before that. Drake didn't make me listen to Ross. I can't think of any of those artists that Drake, me at least. Like I said, some people might say, oh, I heard him on Versace. That made me listen to the Migos. That might be. But I think the Migos would still be the Migos without him on that remix.
Without the
co-sign. They had Fight Night. They had a couple of songs that was buzzing before. I wasn't rocking with the way that they was delivering the ad-libs. I wasn't a fan of them back then. Still not really a big fan, but they've grown on me a little bit. I got a couple of joints I can listen to. But it wasn't because, oh, Drake is on that. Let me get him a chance now. Like, nah, for me. And again, if anybody did, let me know. Who did Drake introduce you to? He might have made the label some money, but he also gets credited for those number one singles, whatever. So he's taking credit for that. When he says, I got 13 or 14, whatever the number is now, he's taking credit for those remixes and things or them songs that he jumped on. Cool.
Yes.
That numbers game, you got that. And I said that. He's the best artist. To me, Cole's the best lyricist. And Kendrick is the best at album creation and putting it all together. To me.
Okay.
Drake gonna give you the hits and constantly. He don't take breaks. He don't take time off. He's constantly working. He's always somewhere. He was at Sexy Red's birth, allegedly, for the video. Like he's busy. He did more for Sexy Red's kid already than he did for his own son. I'm just putting that out there.
I'm sorry.
But listen, we didn't see the home videos of him and Adonis, but we seen home videos of him, you know what I'm saying? He getting Sexy Red to the hospital. Listen, but he busy. But she the new artist now. So again, if the label said, hey, help put her on, then maybe he's put, I believe her song Pound Town is still bigger than, for her at least, that put her on before Rich Baby Daddy.
Yeah.
Pound Town made her famous. So she is who she is before Drake. Rich Baby Daddy might be her biggest hit.
I'm not disputing that these people wouldn't be who they are because of Drake. I'm just saying he elevates the stock. Just a little
bit. For the label. He makes money for the label.
That's right.
So going back to his thing about Kendrick being used or extorted, who's really the worker out here? Who's really the one that's constantly working for the man, for the machine? Who's doing it?
It's hard to say.
They go and make a song for the Swifties. Meanwhile, you making songs with Sexy Red. You making songs with Four Bats. You making you out here busy. You out here busy. You real busy. Talk about he made a song for the Swifties. You making songs for everybody. You making songs for everybody because Lucian said so. Because Jay Prince said so. You did a whole concert because Jay Prince said so. You don't get breaks. You don't get time off. You mad, you rushing Kendrick because he's spending time with his family. He said, you don't know nothing about that. But you mad because he take vacation time. He take breaks. He go to therapy. He try to get closer with his wife and work through some things. He enjoying the fruits of his labor. He said, I'm reaping what I sowed. You know what I'm saying? I put in that hard work to let me relax. You don't want to relax, and that's cool. You go hard. But who really getting worked? Who's really getting extorted out here? You doing all that work for the labels. All them numbers is cool. I'm Michael Jack. Cool. You did all that. When you gonna enjoy it? And do you? And is that your euphoric feeling? The constant working. Is that what keeps you motivated and feel good about yourself? Is that it?
Is that? That's a better question. If it does make him feel.
Is that what drives you? You want to, and again, I said that LeBron comparison, the numbers, you chasing somebody, you chasing goals, you trying to be better than somebody on the numbers game. But is your impact as big? And I feel that's the deep rooted issue that he has with Kendrick, because Kendrick can move the needle without even trying. He gets the respect of the culture and of the industry and colleges studying albums. He's like, yeah, but I got no more singles. I got to, yeah, that's cool. But this body of work right here is being studied in Yale. Mm. He just got a Pulitzer Prize or something like. And again, those are more accolades. But Kendrick can do. Kendrick gets hits or big singles without having to do the formulaic thing, swimming pools and stuff like that. That song was. I hated that song when it first came out. But swimming pools was played everywhere. And until I heard it in the context of the album that I even like it. But at first, I'm like, yeah, this song sounds stupid. But it buzzed. Kendrick is a mainstream artist without even trying. You don't even see him. He's not out in the public. He's not doing all this stuff in your face. But he's big in the industry. And I think Drake hates that. Because they're polar opposites. Yeah. They're literally polar opposites. And that's what the conflict, I believe, is. So I can pinpoint... To my belief, what their beef is, I don't care about, he slept with Future's girl or whatever they're saying or such. I don't even care about none of that. Him and ASAP Rocky's beef is over Rihanna and his baby mom, because Rocky had to also take the paternity test to find out if the kid was his. So that's women. I don't even care about that. But the reason Kendrick and Drake is so personal is because When Kendrick made that control verse, Drake's response to it was very condescending. He did the Elliot Wilson interview, and he was like, "Oh, it was a moment. Nobody cares about that song." 10 years later, we still talking about that song, a song that was never released. It was never released. Cole's point: "Oh, you dropped 4 albums in 12 years." Da da da. But look at them albums. Good Kid, Mad City, To Pimp a Butterfly, Damn. Like, look at those albums. Mr. Morale, even though people, again, it didn't stream and it didn't sell as well, but people were talking about that album. So with less, he can make an impact. He even said it. I make music that electrifies them. You make music that pacifies them. Entendre's in there that we won't even, but he mentioned that restaurant in Chinatown in Toronto, and he's just going to eat. I don't think that was his intention. You know what I'm saying? And the control verse, he mentioned names. Everybody woke up like, come on, chill. Why you? People had reactions to it. Cole's reaction was people telling him, how you gonna respond to that? Big Crit had a song about how am I supposed to respond to this. Wale made a couple bars in a song. How am I supposed to respond to this? Other people responded. Drake's response was on an interview. Nobody talking about that song, but literally everyone's talking about that song. You just got asked about that song.
Because it addressed him. But right. I got what you're saying.
You know what I'm saying? So he tried to downplay it and then sneak dissed him. So then they went back and forth sneak dissing each other. You know what I'm saying? So I believe at that point, it became a point where it's like, yo, then Good Kid, Mad City comes out and everybody's like, yo, why is this album so big? And this dude's not even trying to be a superstar. He's a superstar. He don't do the interviews. He's not. We don't know who he's dating. We just saw his wife on the cover of the last album. We still haven't even seen J. Cole's kids and wife. You know what I'm saying? But Drake has to do so much to be in your face. He has to constantly be in your face. And again, I don't know if that's him personally wanting to continue to be relevant, you know, or if the label's making him work or what it is. He got to be exhausted. He got to be tired. Take a break, dog. Take a nap. You know what I'm saying? Take a nap. Like, yo, chill. You and Adonis just go, you know what I'm saying? Go somewhere and chill for a minute. It's cool. Yeah. You can take some time off. If the industry didn't have a new Drake feature or song, I think we would be okay for a minute. I think we'd be okay. I think so. But either he's not allowed to, or he don't want to. And it's something to unpack with either one.
But not for nothing. Whatever the agreement is for Drake, right? One thing is absolutely substantial and very true. Arguably, he's been number one for over a decade now.
Again, for the numbers game, yes.
He's numbers been number game. One. Numbers game, yes.
Yeah.
Numbers sure. game, he is number one. And, you know, there's going to come a point where, I think it's going to happen sooner than later, after this happens, after whoever decides to stop responding to each other, we're going to get a break from Drake.
He needs it.
We're going to get a break. No. Bro, it's going to get to a point where, like, not having a Drake album, like how Jay would release year after year,
mm-hmm.
it's going to be one of those.
And if Jay Prince makes him stop again, it's going to be bad. If he loses, it's going to be bad. If Jay Prince made him stop the battle against Pusha T. So if Jay Prince comes in again, that's going to be two times. Because everybody talk about how much of a battle rapper he is, whatever. But it's like, yo, he only beat Meek Mill. It's not saying much.
It's not.
It's not saying much. But when you got tested by, again, Joe Budden, he responded to, but kind of, again, it was subliminal. Pusha T, you finally responded to after some time abating, and you got killed, and your man stepped in and said, okay, it's over. And now we're here. This will be another L. And it'll be a bad look for him. And it might damage his career. But again, it has to be clear. If Jay Prince stops it, that's clear. Come on, so are we doing this again? Now, if they go back and forth, and again, both of them are petty. I don't even know if they would want to stop. I don't know if Kendrick and Drake would want to stop because they're both very petty and condescending. So I don't see who quits, who says, all right, I'm done. Unless the public says, yo, you're losing, stop. You know what I'm saying? So I don't know who stops, but, you know, if Drake takes it, if Kendrick takes an L, it's a bad look for him too. Don't get it twisted. I just think Drake would care more.
If Kendrick loses, he still has his core audience. He still got his
same.
If Drake loses and he's 0-2, in my personal opinion, I think Drake has a lot to lose.
Yes, because which speaks to Kendrick putting the Richard Pryor sample in the beginning of the song, that, you know, the wizard, the Wiz, and him being the wizard and saying it's true, everything they say about it's true.
Yeah, my phone.
If he loses this, the mystique of the wizard is gone.
Yeah.
The mystique, the curtain is pulled. You just a regular human. You're not the wizard no more. Yeah. You're just a regular human, dog.
Yeah.
Oh, he bleeds. He's not magical. He's not, he's just regular. That's what it would come to, yeah. Which is, so, but Kendrick has to do that now. you set it up. You putting the Richard Pryor sample in there. You saying you gonna pull the curtain. He got to pull the curtain. So he I mean, I got some balls, you know what I'm saying? But but you know what I'm saying? Like Kendrick is saying that he gonna do that. So he has to follow through. So his next joint, each one of them gotta go up on the next one. They gotta keep getting and it's like, what more? Cause Kendrick already said, I'm not researching you. I'm just telling you how I feel about you.
Yeah.
Cool. But you can't keep saying the same thing. So what more do you have to say? Same thing for Drake. You can't keep telling us he's short. You can't keep telling us he got low feet. What more do you have to say?
Is it time to hit the red button? Is it time to hit? I don't think it's time to hit the red button.
If he has, again, if it's going to be gossip, it got to be how he says it. And Kendrick, his whole career, and again, the opposition of the both of them, Kendrick has been more open with his personal life. The therapy, he talk about, you know, getting punked, beat up. He talk about stuff he went through. He gives us more personal stuff. So what is it that Drake can say that we don't already know that could really scathe him? And vice versa. What can Kendrick say about Drake that some people already feel or haven't already said too? That's the bad thing about battling somebody that's already about three battles deep. Everybody kind of already said Joe Budden was the first one to put out that he got his abs, you know, he got the lipo and stuff in his abs. Drake, Pusher already put out about his son. Like,
yeah.
So we've heard it all already, kind of. So that's the bad thing about battling somebody that has already went through battles, because what else you got that we haven't already heard too? You know what I'm saying? And the sexy red line, that's what I'm saying. The sexy red line was something new. You know, about him, you want to be a bad bitch. You trying to dance with them. Like, that's something new. And then, like I said, for Kendrick, what can Drake say if he, because again, he mentioned Whitney's name. A lot of people saying, oh, he's alluding to Whitney cheating with the bodyguard. Whatever. I just think he used the bodyguard like Whitney from the movie, The Bodyguard.
The movie,
he just wanted to say her name. And if people say, oh, you went too far, he's like, I didn't say her name. I was saying the movie. I think that was his out. That was his out to say, oh, because he did it with Pusha T, where he said Virginia, which is his wife's name, and he said it like in a bar that was kind of like, no, I wasn't talking about her, wink, wink. I was just talking about the state of Virginia, where he's from. Pusha T's from Virginia, wink, wink. Like, you know what I'm saying? So he just wanted to throw the names in there. So then now people could say, no, he wasn't saying that. Why Kendrick had to bring up his kid? Because he brought up his wife. No, he said, I'm with the bodyguards like Whitney Houston. No, he's witty. He's smart with his bars. We on to you. So if she did cheat, or if she did, and if he has proof of that, you know, or something, now it's gonna come off real gossipy. That was also the argument that Drake fans had against Pusha T. All he did was say gossip. All he did was spill tea. Your man about to do the same thing. He's saying the same. He's like, oh, that's not even all I know. I got more tea, girl. Let me call you later. That's how he ended the song. That's not even all I know. I'm gonna tell you some more.
So, and you know, not for nothing. No, I was just gonna say because Dopey Freestyle wasn't like it was pretty good. The only thing though is the story of Adidon just revealed his son, which kind of.
And like, I think that's what's missing so far in this battle. There's no "oh" moment from neither one of them.
Yeah.
There's nothing from either one of them. So we'll the conversation continues. We'll pick it up later. You know what I'm saying? Thank you, Steve, for having this conversation with me.
Brother, thank you for having me, bro. Huh?
To be continued is all I can say. To be continued.
I'm pretty sure we're gonna have this conversation once. Round 2 picks up, right?
All right, sir. Enjoy the rest of your night.